I've been told this hall has been used for decades as a drawing hall for the architecture students. Today, our panel will draw an image of an ongoing discussion concerning the role of the students' union in Europe. The topic of tonight's panel discussion is between fighting for students' rights and providing services. What are students' unions responsible for? The discussion will be chaired by a good friend of mine. She's a journalist at the Austrian Press Agency. She's a very well-known debater in all of Europe. And I don't often meet somebody as eloquent and diplomatic as Madeleine Staudmeier.
Thank you, Ricardo. That was very nice. Not that awesome. Thank you. Denmark orders a cut in international student numbers. Spanish police sieges student unions in Barcelona during the referendum. British students call for a second referendum on Brexit. Amid a changing political climate all over Europe, Austrian student unions are no exceptions to be at variance with the government. All over Europe, students voice their opinion in various ways. I beg the audience to share their experiences, their hopes and fears later on. We're really interested in your stories in your countries as well. So Austria is now just an example of what we're going to discuss a little bit. Because what is the main focus of student unions? Is it to voice their opinion, their political opinion? Or is it to focus and concentrate on providing services? The new government in Austria, almost 9 months in power, seemed to make their standpoints clear. The new government postulates the means of student presentation could solely be used for consultation and representation of students' interest. That's up to debate. To discuss this topic, I have the pleasure to introduce Sidi Malma, to your left and to my right. She was a member of the student union herself, and later on, member of the National Council from 2013 to 2017, for the Green Party. To your right, Professor Dr. Wittuch, head of the University Klagenfurt, and Vice President of the University Conference, so an association that supports universities in Austria to promote science and research. Also to your right, Hanna Lutz, probably a friend of yours and the current head of the Austrian Student Unions and a law student. And to your very left, I have the pleasure to introduce Robert Napier, also a friend of yours and the vice president of the European Students Union from the University of Malta, but currently local in Brussels. Thank you that you can make it to be here. Thank you very much. Ms. Mauer, it's a very bully description by the new government in the government program. What signal does the government want to send? What do you think? And what is your view on what are students' interests? How could we define it, or how do you define it?
For the first question, what does the government want? We've had a discussion that's been ongoing for quite some time about the student union involvement in anti-fascist protests. And we now have a far right-wing government, and of course they are not happy about this. And they've always tried to lower the money that the Austrian student union receives. They always tried to get rid of the obligatory membership that we have, and that actually secures the financial basis and the independency of the Austrian Union, and I guess it's also a kind of message that they want to send. The thing is that we have a very strong law that defines defines what the Austrian Students' Union has to do and how it is structured. And I would say the Austrian Students' Union is, like, from a legal base, it's one of the strongest that I know worldwide, actually. And it's not so easy to get rid of it, right? And it's not so easy to turn it down. It was tried, like, there were several tries already in the first round when we had a right-wing government in 2000. In the beginning of the 2000s, they also tried to change the voting system in order to get conservatives to win the elections, but it didn't work out. So we had left-wing coalitions in the Austrian Students' Union for quite some time now. So that's kind of the political frame that or context that you have to see this in. For the other question, what is the role of the student union? Like, it's in the law, actually. It says that the Austrian Students Union has to speak for the study-related and common interests of students. So it is in the law that it's not only about, introducing people to university or anything, but also to say something about other interests that students have, which could be, for example, housing. That is something that every student is concerned with. But of course, it's also if you have a situation where right-wing extremism is on the rise again, of course, that's also a very important task that student union needs to tackle in democracy, I think.
So you think it's a common interest of students that they have, that they want to see human rights protected?
Well, we have elections, right? It's not there's some president instated that just doesn't even some people like they want, but there are elections and there are election programs, and we have the situation that there's a majority in this coalition that wants to fight fascism. Actually, I think that it should be standard, but it's not standard anymore, as we see. So of course that's a common interest. And also, students have always been quite a vital part in societal change, and also a vital part of democracy. And it is absolutely necessary to ensure that democracy persists. And I did not think when I was president of the Students' Union myself in 2009, we had huge protests, and it was also not a good situation, but I could have never imagined that we could seriously have to discuss democracy, democratic institutions, human rights, and fight for them again in a way that we do now. I would not have believed you if you had told me back then.
I guess that we all share that feeling, and I know that Zalito also has a little bit of a similar opinion, but I want to get right into where we might differ a little bit. And you told me that certain activities you would describe as romantic rhetoric by the student unions. Could you maybe describe a little bit what you mean by that and where the problem in that lies?
Okay, you're ready. Thank you. You're really starting with the one controversial point, maybe. First of all, I have to apologize because I'm lousily prepared, and the reason for this is that we had budget negotiations for our university yesterday, which took 8 hours of negotiations, and now we do have a budget, and one person fundamentally responsible for this budget is on the podium, because Sigrid Mauer was a member of parliament more than 1 year ago, and in the course of some pretty improbable events, there was the decision of the parliament to raise Austrian University's budget, and that's the fruits of it. Thank you for this. The controversy. Let me state first that I see some very strong reactionary traits by now they are pretty openly stating that what they want, at least what some of them want, is going back behind some things that the 68 revolution brought, because that's leftist things, and now we have a right government, and now it's over with all this leftist nonsense, which includes women's rights, which include the law of abortion, for instance. And since many of these movements and the strong part of the 68 movement was the students' movement, I think we're in the middle of the topic. The controversies and the statement with the romantic idealism relates to the very long, to the decade-long arguments and discussions we had in Austria about admission to universities, because this was and still is a very liberal situation in Austria, the so-called free and open access since the 1970s. Free meaning that there are no tuition fees, open meaning that all you need to have is a high school degree in order to enroll basically every discipline you want, including medicine and so on. Yes, we have strong words about if this is a good idea and if this leads to universities actually having the means to bring good quality education to the students. But that's basically a discussion between ethos, ethics, and ethics of responsibility, and I think it's pretty evident that young people and students' unions are more on the idealistic side, and older people are more on the pragmatic side.
A very interesting question. Should the student union care more for the students involved right now, or in general, or the whole society, which can still enroll to the university and become students? I think that's one of the questions we wanted to raise.
The difficult question is probably what are the interests and the best interests of students? But to use the opposite of an example, to do just service to students, to sell some scripts and offer some servicing, we don't need no student unions for that. Universities could do that. Universities could do that by themselves. So if that's the purpose, we don't need it. So it can't be the purpose.
Hannah Lutz, you have been, I think, in June elected to be the spire of a new student union in Austria. When I read some articles in the press about that, in the comment section, you find a little sympathy for what student unions sometimes do. Obviously, this is the way often people communicate very badly in the public sphere. But what would you say to those people who just say it's a waste of money, a waste of resources? How do you justify political engagement over providing services?
First of all, I think it's important to say that doing politics doesn't contradict doing service. It's not a question whether either or. It's a question of how do I combine it? How do I accompany the service I do with the right politics that I can actually go on doing the service I do? I mean, let's talk about student housing, for example. One part of our work revolves all around helping students finding housing they can actually afford, helping them if they actually have to take someone to court, paying for their legal fees. This is one part of the work we do. The other part is that we come up with new ideas for student housing, that we negotiate with the government on how to make it a bit more affordable. And if those negotiations don't work, well, then we have to find other ways. We have to make what we want public. We have to take it out to the streets. We have to go demonstrate. And at the end of the day, we need to try to put pressure on those who actually make the decisions, because we are the ones who advocate for students which are having the problems. To me, it's just not politics or service, or service over politics, or the other way around. It's how do we do justice to the students that we actually have to represent. And I don't think that you can sort of draw a line in the sand and say, this is as far as we go, and we can't go past that. There's not some definite way to say, this interests students, this is in students' interest, but this isn't. For example, right now, we have a referendum on women's issues, and we have stuff from equal pay to equal rights, body autonomy, and for us as a half, it was clear that we have to support it, because when you look at universities, we still have more women growing, and still only a quarter of professors are women. So we can't say that we're for liberation, that we want women to stand up, that we want women to fight for their rights, and on the other hand say, well, as soon as you leave university, we don't care anymore. As soon as you leave the premises, it's not our business anymore. So we have to support that as well. And today I saw, fun fact, or rather not fun, the government right now cuts funding for women's projects in the amount of about 250,000 euros. And that's it's the exact same amount used for security detail of our foreign minister's wedding, where Putin attended. And if we don't say that that's seriously screwed up, if we don't shout out and say that, you know, the line has been crossed here, then who will? And I mean, we are the ones who are going to sort of be the ones society is going to be us in a couple of years. So if we don't say that that's crossing the line for us, I think we will be failing.
Do you think you will be successful, or do you feel you are being successful?
There are a couple of things which are in the governmental program right now, from tuition fees to controlling us even more, and we're fighting that with everything we have, because it's the same, it's not just for students' union, but if you say workers' unions or students' unions in school, if they have to answer to anyone else than workers or students, let's say if in a school the students' union has to answer to a teacher, well, I don't think that would work quite well. So we are fighting with whatever we have, but not the ministry can't just come and say, well, we like what we do here, we don't like what we do here, so please stop doing that or we're going to cut the funding, because it's not how representation works.
Robert, so far the focus was on Austria and the situation is still on the screen, but we had some trouble in Malta as well, which put you in a little bit of trouble. Can you please tell a little bit about that?
Yes, thank you. So yes, as all of you know, before my time in SOI, I used to be the representative in KSU, and over there we did have to face the government on multiple issues. The latest issue my time in KSU before leaving was the fact that the government was trying to take away the autonomy of the University of Malta. And this was being done by proposing a new University of Malta Act, which governs the education system in Malta, and giving the power for the government to automatically appoint more than half of the council by direct appointments. And needless to say, tackling this was not an easy task, because as you all know, and I'm preaching to the wrong man here, when you are speaking to authorities, sometimes you are taken as just the student and just the one who wants to oppose everything that's being proposed, and we don't see the positive sides of it. But we have to be realistic, and if back then we shut up and let the government do whatever they wanted, then the University of Malta right now would be facing serious threats. And our approach was completely different. Our approach was, let's meet up with the minister. We were given a lot of adjectives to describe how we were acting, because apparently we were being extremely ungrateful, and we were not realizing the benefits of having the government control the taxpayers' money and how this being spent at the university. But 2 months later, when the government was about to start working for another election, this proposal had to be taken up, because we as KSU managed to make everyone realize that there is a third idea. And now we are adopting a new University of Malta, which needs university still as autonomous as it was before, with more student representation at every level, with more student representation at Senate level and at council level, and less people.
Well, that's very inspiring to hear, and congratulations to you. Really, that success.
Do you have any support outside of the student body?
Yes, and here is where I think our role needs to be very well defined. Not everybody is against the student's body, because sometimes when you are working and only finding walls in front of you, we might feel that we are alone. But I think this is a general feeling that anyone who is at any point involved in the student's union feels. Because you open the media and you comment about the students after you, and you go to an interview and you are treated like anyone who doesn't have anything to say. You go to a higher level meeting and you are treated as just a student. But then there are people who have the genuine interest of students. There are genuine politicians, as hard as it is sometimes to believe, we still have some of those. And there were a lot of people who are working there, including the academics and the member of staff. Because sometimes, yes, it really depends on the approach you take. And this is something that I think we'll speak about this later. It's one of the advantages, one of the biggest tricks that being a student activist teaches you is knowing how to read candidates and knowing who can be on your side and who no matter what you do will always remain against you. And finding the right people to help you lobby was one of the things that I learned from the students union, through the students movement for sure, and yes, there were a lot.
Thank you, and yeah, please later on share certain ways how you got there. One way to protest, but you've a little bit in trouble, Siki Mauba. Since 2010, you are on the extremist list of the government, and two more years to go, or your time during your student union, would you recommend Hannah Lutz to do the same thing, to protest in the parliament?
Yeah, well, that's like I was, but it's true that I was on a list. Theoretically, the state should actually have been deleted years ago, and also the minister back then apologized for putting our data in this database, but obviously it's not been deleted or something, I don't know exactly. So there's this huge scandal going on about a part of the state police. Obviously they did not delete my data, or they made copies of it, I don't really know. But I got in this...
That's because you look dangerous.
that's another part of the story. So it was in 2010 when the government made a new budget, and they cut family allowance. Family allowance is, I don't know if you're familiar with that, it's money that is given to families, actually to parents, in order to pay for their kids. And this used to be paid until you were 26, if you were studying. And they cut this down to 24. And they did this in autumn, and they put it through parliament on the 22nd of December. So it was very cold, it was very rushed, and we did not really have a lot of possibilities anymore to go against this. So we did something which is quite common in Austria. We went into parliament and shouted our claims and threw leaflets down to the parliamentarians. And the effect of that is that you are not allowed to enter the parliament for a certain amount of time. And actually this used to be like a very standard thing for every president of the student union. So of course I would recommend this. The other thing is that like parliament is to be, like I was a member of parliament for the past 4 years, and now it's being, they have to do a lot of changes because it's, the building is in very bad shape. But when it's going to be reopened in 2021, there's going to be a glass thingy, so you cannot throw any leaflets down to the parliamentarians anymore. So it's not going to be possible for a long time, so take a chance. The thing that I like, it's kind of a funny story also, because like I still had, as a president of the student union, I still had appointments, and quite a lot of appointments in parliament, and I was only allowed to get in with two bodyguards guarding me. So they would guard me and get me where I needed to go and pick me up again to make sure that I did not do, I don't know what they imagined that I could have done, and it was totally stupid, but yeah. So yeah, but no, I would still recommend to protest, like to use every creative way of protesting in this, like in our situation it was 22nd of December. I mean, nobody cares about politics at that time, and it was the only way to still get some attention to the problem. Of course, I would still recommend to people.
Then it's about attention. There's obviously a very charming and funny side, but there's also a little bit of a rough side, and this was not conducted by the student union, but also by a very right-wing group, and you were actually a victim of violence, Professor Wittuch, and as far as I know, you have been punched in the stomach, and they have not been prosecuted, even though you have pressed charges. How do you deal as a rector of a university with those kind of incidents?
That's probably a difficult point, because it shows that despite there being many student revolutions that we all think about, 68, Prague Spring, Arab Spring, Tiananmen Square, and so on, there were, of course, also student movements in the 1930s, which were anti-Semitic, fascist, and part of the fascist movements of the time and of the Zeitgeist, which also partly seems to hold for the so-called generation identity, which is of course not a generation, but in Austria a very small group of maybe 50 people or so. They planned an attack to a lecture at our university. Very few of them were actually Carinthians. They were imported from Styria to bring a bunch of 10 people together. And yes, I was very close to the lecture hall when it happened, so I got in. I tried to get them out, which didn't work. Then I called the police by phone. Then they left, and then I tried to get hold of two of them to have an identity check by the police, and in the course of those events I got punched in the stomach by one of them. But they were prosecuted, and they were not judged for what's it called, an incitement, but they were judged for Nötigung and Körperverletzung. So there was a judgment based on at least, which was, I don't know, 170 euros.
They're not an extremist.
I don't know, but the prosecution goes to the second round. But they're not as dangerous as in our
country. But when the student union, you as a rector and also as a vice president and former president of the university conference, how does the student voice or the student opinion get through to the university conference, and what does it not really matter in what you do at your conference?
I think the problem was that we had indeed quite some disagreement on the big topic of university admissions. And now, as this is partly through, also with a better financing basis, we're kind of beyond this. And actually what we see now is that there's some quite strong collaboration, for instance, on the topic of new stipend programs, similar to a basic income for students as in Scandinavian countries, to give them the possibility to focus on the studies. Which is also good from an economic perspective, because then they pay higher fees sooner, and it goes into an economic cycle that's a good investment for the state. This also entails the family allowance not being paid to the change and mold into a science program is basically can for the students themselves. So we have a joint paper on this initiative. We are already presented it to the Ministry of Science, and maybe somebody can help.
Mao has once said in an interview that the student work is not a political playground. And do you share that feeling that it is very serious, and do you feel like you are being taken seriously by politicians and university institutions?
Well, of course it's important, and of course it's not just some kindergarten where we play and try things. It's people's futures we're talking about. And for example, when we're working on a new allowance system, we're working on getting kids to university, we're working on people who come from backgrounds which the parents maybe can't afford paying the mini allowance to study, that they can actually do it. So I think this is very important work. I do think that if we reach common grounds, that we are taken serious and that we can work together and find new things we'd like to try out together. That not only with universities, but also with the ministry or with the government. On the other hand, there are, of course, there are other fields where we aren't, I don't think we'll reach consensus too soon. For example, when it comes to university admission, we think that just a couple of years ago, we revolutionized the system in Austria to have one standardized test for everyone who gets out of school, with the same questions and the same grading. And so we built a system where everyone at the end, when they're finished with their 12 years of school, has the same standardized test. And now, and we have this sort of admission period for the first semester in almost every study. And now we're talking about implementing more tests. And our basis is that we already have a test. We have tests everybody can take, and if you succeed, then you should be able to start your studies in whatever you want without having to take another test. And for example, for myself, in school I have about 12 subjects. You come to the University of Vienna with over 150 different career paths you can choose. And I found that was quite hard for me to actually find something that I liked or find something that I know what it's about. I mean, you have all these subjects where you read the name and the title and the curriculum, and you're not really sure what it is. So I think it's vital to let people try it out for themselves. I mean, let them study, let them see if they like it, and if they don't, then they'll choose something else. And for that, I think we need to change something of the system, because the orientation we have at the beginning of your studies isn't good. I think that's something that everyone would, to a certain point, sign off on, that the orientation we give our students could be way better. So I think we should focus on these things instead of trying to keep people out or keep people from starting a certain, to start studying something. And we as OHAR, we have these programs where we take kids to school, school kids, and we show them what they can do. We show them different possibilities. And most of the kids afterwards, when they come, they don't tell us that they found what they want to do, but they tell us that they found what they definitely don't want to do. So the things that they thought they really wanted to do, the things that they look at the end of the day, they come after seeing one or two lectures and come to us and say, well, that would have been bad. And I think that's very important to help people with that decision, to guide them, but not with a test. Because that's always just, you know, I can feel good on the day of the test, I can feel bad, and that shouldn't decide my entire future.
And I know it's just spoke about the moment when we find common grounds. From a European standpoint, that might be difficult, and a lot of different students have, especially in the time where independent movements are rising more and more, and also students have different opinions on that. Is it easy to find common interests and how to represent it as a representative as a PSU?
So I think over here everyone can agree that reaching common consensus is never easy, and we joke around with the amendments that we already something that at the end is always there. At the end of the after every BM, we somehow managed to come up with one common proposal. And that is something that in itself is something to be extremely proud of us as well. Because we are coming from 39 different countries, 40 students representing different ideologies, representing different cultures, and representing different concepts. And somehow, even though there are long and long days of discussions and amendments to amendments, somehow we always manage to come up with one common solution. And that solution is always for the better of our members. And that is then what guides the rest of the executive committee in every decision, in every speech of the late, in every panel discussion. And that gives us a lot of hope. Because if we are finding a common agreement between 39 countries, then we must really be focused on the students' rights, and we must really be focusing on the right things. So despite the fact that it is not easy, and we all admit that it's not easy, it's worth it. Because then when we go at the European level, and we represent our policies, and we represent our statements, we represent on what we agree, then we reach great things. A very simple example is what is happening right now with the refugee. We've been speaking about this even during the past 3 days. Agreeing on the statement for the ministerial conference was still not easy. Because obviously we still have different ideologies and we still have different priorities. But we went to the ministerial conference with one statement, which for us meant that we had the groundwork done and we could lobby for everything that we wanted to protect students' rights. And with that, the community passed, and we are now going to the BFG meeting in the next few days. And that's just going to have the power to continue working on what the ministers proposed to them. And the European Students' Union is the one presenting the terms of reference to start working on something that the ministers agreed on. And on a statement that has managed to pass during the last year. So it's not easy, but it's definitely working.
When you look at the political climate changing dramatically, do you still think that you're representing the majority of the students?
I say yes, and I say yes for one simple reason. All our members are elected democratically. That is one of the membership criteria to become a member of ESSO. And therefore, I have a strong belief that our members are representing the situations in their country in the most democratic way possible. And therefore, I think that yes, despite the fact that there are changes in current political ideologies all across Europe, I think that this body of students of Ghana is a truly democratic one, which represents the different ideologies that exist for students.
Hannah, with the Austrian politicians and political landscape, the majority of a right-wing conservative party government, do you think you are, from a different political point of view, representing the majority of the students' opinion?
Said we are elected and we have elections every 2 years. We have our programs, we stand for the students, tell them what we want to do for the next 2 years, and at the end of the day, coalitions form. And I do think that it's very important that we, as a counterpart to what is happening right now, are as strong as we can be. Because right now, I mean, we have a minister for internal affairs who talks about concentrating refugees. And well, not much happened. He's still there. Yesterday, in the evening, there was a paper leaked from his ministry telling the people who work there not to talk to media which has been critical of them in the past. And these are things which are really shocking, which are really dangerous for our democracy. So I do think that standing up for that isn't leftist or ideological or too radical. I think that's our duty as not only student representatives but as citizens. And it's not something that, I don't think it's something we can choose. We can talk about, yeah, should we say something, should we start a debate? It's something we have to do because if there's one thing that I do think that there is a pretty broad consensus in the population, it doesn't even, and it doesn't really matter what the government is doing about that, but is that democracy is the best way of living right now. And if we want to keep that, we need to do something, not just we as Guinea, but everyone.
cooperation and what you would wish for from the student union. Or what maybe also have you, take the chance to maybe also say what you would not like to do again, what happened in the past and what you didn't hope so much.
Well, I think we do have a clear common goal, and that is a good level of university education for as many students as possible. And we at certain times we have different ideas about how to achieve this goal, but now we're at least one step further. The goal is the same, and it may be easier now to have some joint efforts for the group. Let me maybe still state a very fundamental point. Since we're academics, I of course have to refer to the research literature. And there's a wonderful book, a huge, impressive volume by a Berkeley sociologist entitled The Chosen. And this book, The Chosen, is about admission policies in the last century. In the Ivy League, so especially at the big three, Princeton, Yale, Harvard. And what one thing that it shows are the constant quarrels between reformatory rectors, for instance, on topics as the admission of women at these private universities, although the reformatory rectors are often reformatory on a pretty optimistic basis, because they think it's just better for the development of the university, not so much for societal principles, and then student movements, and then very conservative alumni, Boston Brahmins, sometimes religious, who try to avoid it. And another general thing that he shows is that societal movements, such as the human rights movement in the USA, they really change things, and they sustainably did so, because what we have now in the United States is affirmative action, for instance, on an ethnic basis for African Americans. What we don't have in the United States is affirmative action for white trash people. So if you're white and if you're from a poor family, you're still incredibly underrepresented at the top Ivy League universities, because there never was a social movement that really fought for that right and achieved the rights in the end. So that's a pretty clear lesson that social movements can achieve some things, and if they haven't been there, there are also not achievements that we would need for, well, a more just society.
So you're totally fine with Hannah Lutz protesting in the parliament and at a university and moving forward with movements.
Maybe I can get onto this list.
I try.
You tell me how to do it.
I tried to do it in free stuff now in the parliament, but I mean, they have two securities, they looked at us, only women. One looked at the other said, girls.
I think the goal is that you at least achieve something, and I think the goal shouldn't be even extremist, but political, to bring the political message across. But you as a politician, when you look back from your political, active political time, and on the university time, when you were active as a student union, do you think there was a big difference, or student union members would like approach you as a politician? Would it still have the same seriousness, or do you say, oh, it's, we were so cute back then, we didn't know what to do?
So if I understand correctly, if I don't take the student union representatives less serious, no, but of course, when I started as a representative in the student union at the very basic level, I was 20, and Actually, I probably wouldn't have made it and not have made it to president of the Student Union, not have made it to being a parliamentarian, an MP, if I wouldn't have fought for it. Because I was in the Senate in my university in Innsbruck, and I was a young woman. I was one of three women. One of the other women, one of them was the vice rector, and then there was one teacher. So we were 3 out of 24, and nobody would ever listen to me. And just very naturally, as it's always the case, I thought, oh, maybe I'm talking not loud enough, or maybe what I'm talking about doesn't make sense, or maybe, you know, like these kind of things that women often feel like, especially if they're so young. And like, I mean, most people in the Senate were very old men. I actually thought about quitting because I found the situation so bad. But then I one day decided to try one more time, and actually it worked out. And I came late on purpose. it's a crazy story. I came late on purpose and was really, really loud in this session. Finally, I don't know why, but they finally recognized that what I said was actually right. And then at some point they started, the leader of the Senate started saying things like, yes, and as C has already said, and then I didn't say it. So he was suddenly giving me a lot of support for some reason. So I benefited a lot from a situation where somebody encouraged me, and also I did not give up fighting, actually. But I was very close, and I've never gotten into the national representation at this university back then, and not ever at the national level. But of course, like that, I was 20 back then, and now I'm 33, and of course, I've also been in ESU, of course, and as you say, you're negotiating amendments during the day. I mean, that's okay. you're discussing and negotiating amendments the whole night, I hope, still. But of course, I do have a different perspective, and of course, there are things where I'd say, it's not that I don't take it as seriously. For me, the most important thing is always how well things are organized, actually. And I remember that we did a lot of things that were not organized well at all. This is something where, that's the point where I sometimes see things and think, yeah, well, it was the same back then, and we didn't manage, but somehow everything turned out right. But it's not, I'm still taking those two politicians very seriously, and I also, of course, I've changed over 13 years, of course, but still the basic motivation is still the same. That's also something that I also can see here in this room with you people. So it's been the third day, so you're really tired now. it's been long nights, I think it's actually, it's a great time where you can learn so much and achieve so much. I envy you a little.
Do you think that the Austrian student union has a high responsibility right now for the conservative government to be elected?
A higher responsibility, like the responsibility is probably always the same, but obviously that there is at the moment higher necessity. And this is not only something that the student union has to tackle, but also the rectors' conference. and universities all together. Every citizen actually has to be aware of what is happening. We are in a situation where we always said, okay, Hungary, what's happening there, getting rid of the CU and getting rid of gender studies now, actually, this is a story that I was telling you. I'm a scientist now, I'm a researcher now, and I'm working in this project called Eurogradient. It's a pilot study for the EU Commission, and it's done in 8 countries. And one of the countries that was in this project first was Hungary, and they dropped out because we have a part on democracy, and we asked people if they think that democracy is important and if they think that that the justice system should be independent and stuff like that, and they dropped out because they did not want to. They did not even, these are the most basic questions, and they would not allow us to ask graduates if they think that democracy is a good idea. So that's the state where we are at in Hungary. As I said before, I would not have imagined 2 years ago when I was a member of the Austrian Parliament that it would go so fast, and it goes with enormous speed. And yes, I think there's a necessity to go against it. The responsibility, of course it's a responsibility, but obviously this is also not something that the student union can do on its own. It's a huge effort that it needs combined strengths of all kinds of institutions.
Before we come to some last questions, I would really love to hear from the audience if they have questions and also just experience they want to share. There's already someone in the second row.
Hi, I'm Jenny, I come from Finland and I represent the University of Dutch Students in Finland. I would like to go back to the very start of the discussion and the concept of ideology, which for me seems a bit weird to disregard opposing opinions as ideological and the ones in power as the more pragmatic or rational, because at least in Finland, which is a very consensus-based country, that is a very book example of an argument to disregard another opinion. And students' movement exists just to ensure the rights of students. And we have nothing political to win. We work as volunteers to make evidence and policy to influence the needs for students, rather than those in power who then might want to keep that. So I don't see why those decisions would be less ideological than the ones made by the students. Thank you.
So are you, just a quick question, so are you promoting in Finland a more service-oriented student union?
We are mostly advocacy-based student unions. We do provide services for unions as well, but mostly political advocacy.
Robert, did you want to maybe say something on that?
No, I do completely. In this case, we really need to focus that it's not a matter of having to decide between being political advisors, being active on a policy level, being active on a political level, and public services. I really don't think that's what I do. I really think that all the students' unions are there to serve the people more than they are. And if the students who have those needs and services, then we will be there to offer those services. But that obviously does not exclude us from being the people working on, because we can be the true voice of what is needed for policy without having to make them have to do it. Realistically, as was rightly pointed out, politicians have a lot to lose and a lot to gain when they are doing these policies. For students, we are then doing this for free, most of us, and we are then dedicating countless amount of hours and days and nights of debating to try and reach agreement. But for us, the people who are actually working on this are the people who dream it up already. So I don't think that offering them an option to be a student's union, so that says, or a student's union should be working on policies is the idea. Because it's very easy to reach a benefit to people, and I think that's what is the systemic responsibility of the student's union.
Are there some more questions?
Hello, I'm back from Slovakia. Just a short thing. We are in Slovakia, we are very no services, we are not providing services. Are really important. The services you are providing to students.
But I wouldn't say that the Rector's Conference just advocates for government or teachers or anyone else. I think that it depends on the subject. I think it depends on what we're talking about. So I'm very happy about the situation right now, where we're at, and the way we talk to each other, the frequency we talk to each other. I don't think that it's ever been the way it is right now, that we see each other every couple of months and talk about what's new and what we can improve. I really enjoy that, because I do think that together we can do more than alone. But of course there will always be subjects where we don't see eye to eye, and it's often easier to sort of set those aside for the time being, concentrate on what we can actually achieve together, and the other subjects we're working on.
And I was watching her, of course, during this response. I don't know about the situation in Slovakia. I know about the situation in the Czech Republic between the Rector's Conference and the state and the government, because there were strong quarrels concerning the state president Zeman and also the prime minister Babiš. And one of the incidents was that Zeman didn't want to appoint several new professors, because the Czech Republic university professors are appointed by the state president by law, and the reason for that was then being homosexuals. And what then happened was that the Rector's Conference motivated basically all professors to be appointed at this event, not to attend, and just to get their appointment decree on by post office, which was what happened. So I'm telling this because I'm really worried about the situation in several European states by now. Turkey, but also Hungary is the most obvious example, where I have the impression that also the Rector's Conference is already infected. The General Secretary of the Hungarian Rector's Conference seems to be very close to the Orban government. The situation is still different in Poland or in the Czech Republic, but let's see for how long. And I also have my worries concerning Austria, although I think that at the time being we're much more secured about against state interventions by university law. And
we can act on our own, I think that gives us that extra push, that extra right to speak out, that right to be very critical, to really look at everything that happens, that the government does, and say what we don't like, what we don't like, what they need to change. So I think this, especially financial independency, makes them a bit more outspoken and helps us with that.
And Professor Mitchell, do you remember a time when it was really difficult to, have a shared common sense among the student union, besides the admission problem? No pressure.
Well, I think someone can say something to that. Well, the thing is that one of the most important things that you would fight for as a student union and also the practice conference is more money for higher education. So that's always common ground. That's also something that you can start on. And I know that also the conservative rectors, the very heavy pressure on the streets for more funding was organized by the students' union or by the students themselves. So if there's foot power basically on the streets for more money, they're in favor. So
that's the opportunistic motivation I meant.
Yeah. yes, but I actually remember when I was president of the student union, we had, that was in 2009, and it was this time that was called Uni Brennt, university burning, basically, and we were squatting not only the main university in Vienna, the University of Vienna, but also Hegel. People were squatting at all universities in Austria, which is quite strange because Austria is not a country with a tradition of squatting or even big demonstrations. But for some reason, it spread from Austria to a lot of other countries, a lot of your countries as well. You probably participated, maybe, or you heard it. No, you didn't participate. You're too young. We maybe heard about it. And of course, that was a situation where the rectors, not all of them, but a lot of them were not in favor because we were blocking their audiences, their biggest lecture halls, and we were very loud and had a lot of demands. And the rector of the University of Vienna, he even refused to talk to the students, and he's not rector anymore, but he claimed to have gone to the Audimax one day in disguise with a hat and a trench coat to look at what the situation was like at his university, but he did not actually go there to speak to the people. That was different. There were also rectors that were very supportive of the students and of the movement that was active back then. But I remember getting phone calls from professors and also rectors that asked me to end squatting right now, which was not something that I could guarantee or even promise or whatever. So, but yeah, this was a time where major parts of the rectors' conference were not happy with the student union.
We have one more question over there.
Oh, sorry, not a question, a reaction. I'm Philip from the Czech Republic. I'd like to go back to the case of our president not setting into function our professors. I'm not sure whether it was about homosexuality. I think it was about what I've just found Google here, and I'm pretty sure about it. It was that he had personal problems with people, like that one person, according to the our president's information, was active before the year 89 in Stasi, or region of Stasi. And the problem is that all the people who are docents who were associate professors who were ready to get to be professors passed all the legal conditions to do so. However, our president has like magical thinking about our constitution. So I wanted just to clarify that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for sharing. Are there more questions or more experiences?
Hello, I'm from Luxembourg, and we also agree with a lot of which has been said in the sense that US as a student union have a public agency. So of course it's important that you offer services, but it's also important, as you said it very well, you don't stop being part of society the moment you stop being a student. And my question was, do you experience, or if the people you represent basically go against what you think, that they don't think that it's a public responsibility and you should move more to maybe just services? And did you experience this in your very, very different fields, that what you say and what you fight for is no longer the base that you represent? And also maybe you fear yourself for the future if you see a trend. Also, you said a lot that you would have never imagined that back when you were an activist, it would have changed and would be the situation you have now. And like, what are your views for the future and for the public responsible good?
Yeah, Hannah, you might want to start. And you talk a little bit about the public opinion in the press.
Well, there are different opinions. That's why we have elections. That's why we have many different groups that come that present their programs that that want to act later. Right now we have the coalition now. The majority of students who went to the election said that they want university without tuition fees. They want a university that acts out against discrimination, that is there for everyone. So I think that's a very important point. I do think that often what student representatives do, when you look at the comment sections and whatever, I mean, I wouldn't really tell anyone to do that because it can be quite brutal. But if you like that kind of stuff and you look at the comment sections, of course, there are always people that have a problem with what you do. But I do think that the reassurance we get is that is when we can help people. Just a couple of months ago, we won a case in court that got back over 10,000 euros of rent. Students paid illegally because they were told that the house they were living in was a student home, but it wasn't. And these people come up to you and thank you for what you did, and I think that makes everything right again, because you can see what you can actually do, you can see how you can help people, and especially when it comes to discuss to the ongoing discussion we have right now about tuition fees, because they are in the government program. That's we saw it on our Facebook page, but that whenever someone commented that, you know, well, the students again, they're going on demonstrations again, and what did they have to say? We didn't have to do anything anymore because it regulated itself. There were more and more students commenting on the radio, well, if they don't act now, when should they act? I mean, now is the time to do something. So we do get very much positive reinforcement as well, but yeah, comment sections are always
Do you have second doubts sometimes that you think, oh, maybe that's not the majority of the people and who want what we want?
I think that what our main goal is to make studying affordable for everyone. So I do think that that is a goal that most people would sign off on. I guess there are always discussions about how you achieve your goals, and that's perfectly okay. And that's why I think it's really important that we have the elections every 2 years, that we are a representation that is elected by its members, and that we are held accountable for what we do by them, which is the same for any government or any union or representation. So I do think that corrective that we have is very important.
Did you ever have any of those experiences?
If I may add something. First of all, we have to bear in mind that we are representing different people. And obviously different people are going to have different ideas, and that is something that is going to happen in every spectrum of life. And I'll first say something about the national experience and then now with the European. At a national level, for example, when KSU decided to poison one seminar and the assassination of a journalist in Malta, and KSU felt that that was something very big, that was something that was killing the freedom of expression for students and something that was threatening the freedom of speech. And KSU, together with other NGOs, organized one of the biggest protests that there were in Malta. And again, if you open the Times of Malta, you will find the comments about KSU who was here at the time, who spoke at this demonstration, you'll get a bunch of nice adjectives that were used to describe as members of political parties and that we always speak up whatever we want to and that we like, we speak. But the thing was that we always believe that it is our responsibility to fight for students' rights. And if certain people of different ages, of different ideologies were not seeing that, that shouldn't be enough to stop us from acting. And I come now to the European level. At the European level, ESO is obviously mostly based not on services, but on policy. But for example, at the moment, ESO is participating in a project and organizing three different seminars. For us, this is something which is exactly in line with what we do. But we represent 20 million students. So it's impossible that everyone is going to perceive what we are doing in this. For some people, it might seem that wasting our energy on organizing seminars is not worth it, or it's not worth time. But realistically, we believe, for example, that in this particular case, organizing this seminar will give the people in this room the toolkit to then deliver seminars in their own countries to their own students and to their own members to reach out on the particular topics that we are discussing that are on the political priorities of this. So, and here I try to answer you. It is okay to have people who will disagree with you. It's okay to have people who will think that what you are doing is not really for the public good or is a public responsibility. But as long as we keep that in mind, and as long as we do not let anything distract us, I think no comments, no anything should ever be allowed to distract us. And only then we'll be able to pass on the message of education is a public good and a public responsibility.
Professor Mitchell, would you like to add something?
There seems to be one fundamental difference between labor unions and student unions. Not generally, but very often. Labor unions tend to feel responsible for the people who are their members and who have a job. And they try to improve the working conditions for this group, and they pretty much don't care about those who don't. And very often it's with student unions, they care especially about people who are not yet at the universities. Of course, also the opposite exists, and maybe some labor unions at some times where it is the opposite, and same with student unions, vice versa. But I think that's an interesting difference. And the student unions approach is, well, less protectionist, but maybe more like it.
Do you think the students should care more for their members?
That was basically the decade-long war that we had, because university rectors said we can't improve the situation for education, research, teaching, and learning at universities if the request is that much more people can study at universities than the government is willing to pay for budgeting the universities, which is a general phenomenon in many countries that governments and states are not living up to the expectations and to their promises. As in the UK, where conservative governments promotes high tuition fees, and then labor doesn't promote reduced tuition fees, but no tuition fees. So it's going from one extreme into the other. It's often just very difficult to find pragmatic solutions for this and to make a prognosis about what the best achievable solution would be.
And then there's the crucial question again between ideology and pragmatism, and I think that's not easy to answer.
I disagree. You are student representatives, student unionists. I was for a long time, and I still feel very close to the student movement. And I'm my research, I'm in higher education research, so I'm still there. And one point that is very important in all our discussions is always a very important member to all of those Bologna process issues. EUA and Eurasia and directors conferences. And I think that there's one important thing that we have in the social dimension of the Bologna process, which is the goal that in our higher education system, everybody is represented. And everybody, no matter what background they come from, have a chance to go to university. And also the universities know that it is probably also not idealistic, but only pragmatic reasons, know that a more diverse student body is a better starting point for research and science and what happens at universities as well. And so all universities I know do have this goal as well, to have the people represented at the universities and have people from minority groups, etc. there. So if this is a goal that is shared by student unions, by governments, by the European Commission, and by the European University Association, the rectors conferences, I think it's quite strange to say we only care about those that have already gotten in, and we don't care about how we organize the system in order to improve the social dimension. So to me, it's completely logical that a student's union cares about those who have not yet gotten in, and cares about having a broad representation of all kinds of people. I understand, though, and this is a very difficult discussion, that there are different ways on how to achieve this. And also, we know already for a long time that just free and open education does not change the student body enough, so we will have to do a lot more efforts. I don't think that affirmative action is for the European university system something that is actually working quite well, but we have to be a lot more flexible and a lot more supportive to get people from less privileged backgrounds into our universities. And I actually think that this is also the responsibility of universities. This is our job. This is also the reason why the Rectors Conference has an opinion about the schooling system, and has an opinion on if there should be selection at the age of 10. In Austria, we have basically what you're going to do with your life is decided when you're 10 years old.
There's an opinion of the Rectors Conference on that?
Yeah.
And if so, what is the opinion?
The opinion is that the Rectors Conference is in support of a common, of a shared school. I don't know what the assumption is.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. That's and of course, this conference, of course, is also supporting this idea of not separating children at the age of 10, because one of our major problems is that we have the separation in the very beginning, and now and then, like, the problem starts with 10, and when people are 18, 19, the university suddenly should solve it, which is of course not possible, because people drop out of the schooling system before, and if you have a lot of people not even getting to university, to the university entrance certificate, like to matura. Of course, it's very difficult, not to say impossible, to get the others back in. So I understand this problem, but as just my point is, it's very logical and a clear responsibility of students' unions and of rectors' conferences. To not ignore what happens before people enter university.
emotional response, because I feel like this is romantic idealism again, which we talked about in the beginning.
But I do agree with this point. I didn't say I'm with the labor unions. I just wanted to point out the difference. Still, there may be one core disagreement, and that's also a problem for myself. In a way, universities are very much entities in an intellectual sense. So they try to act on a meritocratic basis, and they also get selectivist on this basis. And the idea is that it should have nothing to do with wealth, just with intellectual capacity. But how do you assess this intellectual capacity independent of earlier education career and so on? So we might have some core disagreement about if the top universities are for an elitist intellectual few, or for broader shares of society. I would, for instance, say that as far as I know it, the Californian system is working pretty well. It's probably famous as EHS2, with the community colleges and the state universities and the University of California system as the top layer. But of course, at the same time, it's a very elitist system and very successful in the international rankings. Probably it's the most successful state-financed and state-organized university system in the world from a research and quality perspective.
Robert, you wanted to add?
Just before, when we were speaking about pragmatism and pragmatism, and I was very shocked as well, by the way, also that students and the more different background rather than more pragmatic. And I will give you a very concrete example of how it is the other way around. Ministers from our countries, and when they were drafting communiques, have been speaking about the social dimension for more than 20 years. And we've been speaking about the social dimension because obviously it's a nice term, it makes the country look nice, and we always somehow live it. But when you look concretely at what has been done with the social dimension in the countries, you realize that nothing has been done. And the pragmatic approach is being put by the students who are proposing that finally we take up the social dimension to a level where it is in line with female fees, where the social dimension is no longer something that can be avoided, where it's no longer something that you can decide whether to spend money on it or not. And that is the pragmatic approach of doing things. I think that is what the students' union and how the students' union should act.
That's almost the perfect closing words, but I would like to give the closing words to Sigma Alma, maybe to just give a nice message to the ones who go through the same thing you already went through. Maybe you have a nice message for them. Enjoy!
Concerning tomorrow morning. So we're all going back now to UFA together for dinner, and then there's the intercultural night taking place at the UFA hotel itself. For tomorrow, please be conscious about the checkout time tomorrow. It's going to be at 9 o'clock. You can bring your luggage here. We have a room reserved for you, and there'll be workshops taking place at 9:30 again, one last time. So enjoy the evening tonight, and I hope you had a nice discussion.